former U.S. President Donald Trump is found liable for sexually abusing and defaming former magazine writer E. Jean Caroll in the 1990s. The nine-member jury also ordered Trump to pay Caroll $5 million in damages. Trump, who was absent throughout the trial, called the verdict a disgrace and a continuation of what he claims is the greatest witch hunt of all time. His spokesman says they will appeal that decision. This is the latest legal trouble for Trump amid his bid to retake the White House in 2024. Though this case is unlikely to make a big dent on his campaign, as shown by his improving poll numbers, even after he was charged last month with falsifying business records. The U.S. still under threat of default. This after the high-stakes meeting between President Joe Biden and top congressional leaders over raising the national debt ceiling ended with no breakthroughs Tuesday. After about an hour of talks, both sides showed no signs of softening their positions, with White House Speaker Kevin McCarthy slamming the Democrat-led Senate for taking no action. The two sides will meet again on Friday. The U.S. Treasury has warned the government could run out of cash to pay its bills as soon as June 1st if the $31.4 trillion ceiling is not raised. Hundreds of migrants flocked to the U.S.-Mexico border near San Diego, California, to end off the controversial border policy looms. The policy known as Title 42 allowed authorities to swiftly expel migrants at U.S. land borders, citing the pandemic as a justification for turning them away. It will expire at midnight on May 11. The Biden administration is sending reinforcements to the borders to prepare for a possible surge in illegal immigration. U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken says Washington is not giving up on the goal of putting Sudan back on track to civilian democratic governance. Blinken adds the U.S. government is working in talks with Jeddah to extend the ceasefire between the warring parties.
We have diplomats from the United States and Saudi Arabia deeply engaged in talks in Jeddah, working in close consultation with counterparts from the UK, the United Arab Emirates, the African Union, and other multilateral partners. The collective aim that we have is to lay the foundation for further negotiations between the parties that we hope can lead to a permanent cessation of hostilities. But in the first instance, we're working in Jeddah to extend the ceasefire and get agreement on the provision of humanitarian assistance to the people of Sudan.
The negotiations between the army and the rival paramilitary began on Saturday with no word so far on the progress of the ceasefire talks. Two Filipino women in Sudan cry for help to be evacuated as fighting in the war-torn country drags on. One of them, Rebecca Mendoza, says she has already applied for repatriation, but her employer refused to let her leave.
Nakita po ng aking amo na ako po ay nagpasa ng detalye dito sa aming lugar. Ipinasa ko po sa Egypt ng embassy yung location namin dito. Nagalit po sa akin ang amo ko. Kasi sabi po niya sa akin, ipapahama ko daw po siya sa ginagawa ko. Nag-away po kami ng amo ko noong isang araw. Pinagbablock niya po yung mga nagkontak sa akin dito.
The Philippine Foreign Affairs Department assures them it will find a way to bring them home.
We can ask yung honorary consulate po natin sa Khartoum na gumawa ng paraan para maibigkas siya. Ang una natin gagawin batas sa batas, kausapin natin yung amo dahil since nasa custody siya ng amo, we don't want to be accused na we are kidnapping itong kababayan natin. Of course, ibang klaseng panahon na ngayon sa Sudan, gagawa ko tayo ng paraan, kakausapin muna natin yung amo. And of course, kung talagang ayaw, then we will make plans for her to be released.
On Tuesday, 55 more Filipinos arrived home to the Philippines, bringing the total number of repatriated Filipinos to 475. 18 more are expected to arrive in the country this morning. Authorities say there are still 40 Filipinos left in Sudan who have refused to leave.